So good morning to everyone. I'm David Felio from Scaleagent. I would like to propose a solution to monitor a spacecraft from a smartphone using MQTT and so the protocol MQTT and the message broker Joram. The ability to monitor a spacecraft from anywhere is a real need. The first use case involves on-call operators working outside the control center. So for example, during the weekend, using their smartphone, they can receive alert reports describing anomalies in the behavior of the spacecraft and perform a first level analysis by checking the real-time telemetry. In this way, they can save time and effort. So, a spacecraft is controlled by a control center through one or several ground stations, and the real-time telemetry is published as soon as a ground station is reachable by the spacecraft. The real-time telemetry is transmitted to the control center. And if an anomaly in the behavior, in a parameter, for example, that goes out of range, is detected, then an alert is automatically sent to the on-call operators who can then monitor the real-time telemetry we will see that later, but with MQTT, well, that's the idea. From anywhere, that's the point. At home, from a public place, well, anywhere, as long as there is a connection to internet. The second use case is for science team members remotely working, as their office is outside the mission center. So it's not a control center, it's a mission center. Their office is outside, and they need to monitor the health of the instruments. This situation happens in internationally cooperative space missions. In this use case, the mission center retrieves the payload telemetry from a ground station, processes the telemetry, and also computes some of the values, statuses, and publishes the telemetry, delivers the telemetry to the scientists. There's already some solutions. An existing solution is based on client-server architecture, using HTTP to send requests to a data server. Clients are either laptops or any machine, and also smartphones. So it's using HTTP to request. It's perfect to retrieve data, but for alerts and real-time telemetry, then the client has to poll the server. Security can be easily handled as it's a one-way data flow. It's a low interaction level from a secured zone, the control center, to a less secured zone, the client. There is no data sent by the client to the control zone. So for example, there are no commands sent directly like this from a client to the control center and then to the spacecraft. It's only in this way. So security is, there are less security risks in that case. MQTT, well, you probably all know what is MQTT. It's a lightweight message queuing protocol dedicated to devices with limited resources and using constrained networks in terms of bandwidth and connectivity. It provides, as it has been said, a publish-subscribe interaction pattern, where a message is published once on a given topic. A topic is a subject of interest identified by a name, and every consumer, called subscriber, registered to this topic, receives a copy of the message. MQTT relies on a message broker that sits in the middle between the publisher and the subscriber. The broker brings time decoupling and reliable message delivery. In this way, the publisher can push messages in the broker and terminate, and the subscribers can connect later and retrieve their messages. The solution I would like to propose relies on MQTT. It benefits from an event-driven architecture thanks to the publish-subscribe interaction pattern that allows to push real-time data from the control center and the spacecraft, of course, to the clients. And it's a one-to-many interaction. With a low message transmission latency. So it's a good point for real-time telemetry. MQTT should be more efficient than HTTP, as it uses less bandwidth and power. The time decoupling and reliable message delivery provided by the broker may be useful in some cases. For example, the use case number two, a scientist could be disconnected when the payload telemetry is published. In this case, it can connect later and retrieve the messages. The real-time telemetry is published through a standard service called CCSDS Mission Operations. CCSDS is an organization for standardization of space data systems, in which participate space agencies like NASA, ESA, the European Space Agency, and CNES, the French Space Agency. CCSDS has specified a service-oriented architecture for space activities called Mission Operations, MO. MO consists of standard end-to-end services that can be used on the ground, from ground to space, so on the space link, and in space. One of the main technical benefits of mission operations is to decouple the consumer, the service consumer, and the provider implementation. As MO services specify the meaningful information, so at the semantic level, exchanged between the consumer and the provider. There is no dependency on the different links and protocols. There are many in between, of course. Used underneath, so from the control center to the ground station, and from the ground station to the spacecraft, and after, even on board, they can still have many interactions with relays, a Mars rover, for example. Well, it can be very complex here. It's not just an endpoint. The MO service framework is structured as a stack of layers, protocol layer, abstract protocol layer, service layers, and application. The central layer is the message abstraction layer. It's not messaging, it's message abstraction layer. The MAL that defines a service model, including a data model and interaction patterns, like request-response. There's also request with multiple responses called progress. And there's also a pub-sub, a publish-subscribe interaction pattern. On top of MAL, there are several areas of services, common object model, common services like directory, logging, and functional services like MNC. This is the one we are interested in. The monitoring and control with service to retrieve parameters, receive alerts, and send comments. Well, we are not going to use this one, but the parameter alerts are interesting in this case. So you saw, yeah, the blue books are CCSDS recommended standards, so a lot of paper, like that was said earlier. There are at least one blue book per layer. So let's see this one, the MAL abstraction layer. It's an abstract protocol. So it needs to be mapped to a messaging technology in order to have a real concrete protocol. The data model has to be mapped to a data and coding format. And the interaction patterns have to be mapped to the message sending and receiving primitives provided by the messaging technology. If a publish-subscribe operation is already provided by the messaging technology, then the MAL pub-sub can be directly mapped to the messaging technology. At Scale Agent, we have implemented several mappings. The first one is to Joram, the message broker. We also have implemented a mapping to AMQP. And we have experimented mappings to JMS and MQTT. Finally, there's also this layer here. Well, here, which is an API, a standard API for the MAL that allows to have portable applications written in Java. This is the MAL Java API, and it's also specified but by a Magenta book, not a blue book because it's not a protocol. There are two open source implementations of the MO standard, both in Java and both compliant with the MAL Java API, one by CNES and the other one by ISA. The CNES implementation is used by a prototype of a mission control system. A mission control system is the software running in a control center. The prototype has been developed by CNES, and it relies on Java, OSGI, and Joram. An MO component platform has been experimented based on distributed OSGI and IPOJO. Few words about Joram and MAL Joram and JoramQ. Joram is an open source message broker written in Java. It is available on the OW2 website. It provides two client APIs, JMS API in version 2, and also a C++ API. MAL Joram is an open source mapping of the message abstraction layer to Joram, done by CNES. And it provides the MAL Java API. So this is a MAL Java client using the MAL Java API. And finally, JoramQ is an offering by Scale Agent that relies on Joram and that provides two message queuing protocols, MQP and MQTT. Few words about the MAL Joram mapping. The first key feature is the time decoupling provided by the message broker. Message producers are not tied to message consumers. This is useful in a control center when a consumer slows down. When the consumer slows down. In this case, the slow consumer is handled by the message broker. So it's not going to affect the producers. The second feature is the publish-subscribe interaction pattern with a real space decoupling provided by the message broker. So publishers do not need to know the network addresses of the subscribers. Moreover, Maljoram scales with the number of publishers and subscribers by distributing the broker across multiple servers. Third feature is the message delivery reliability, allowing not to lose any message. There are two examples where this is useful. First, the messages delivered to the data store of the control center. It must be reliable. And the second example is to transmit alerts. Again, alerts need to be reliable, reliably transmitted. And finally, Maljoram provides the ability to multiplex interactions on a single connection and perform flow control between a consumer and a producer and a consumer. MQTT is provided by Joram MQ on top of Joram. Joram MQ fully supports MQTT version 3.1, and we are working on the upcoming 3.1.1. All the QoS levels are supported, and the clean session flag, the topic hierarchies, wildcards, dynamic topic are supported, also the retain messages feature. Joram MQ provides administration tools and security mechanisms, for example, to control the topic access rights. And Joram MQ enables MQTT client to interoperate with JMS and MQP clients. A client can publish with MQTT, and another client can subscribe with JMS. And in this way, the JMS client benefits from the JMS2 feature called shared subscriptions that allows to have parallel consumers, which is more efficient to consume the messages. Joram MQ scales with a number of clients in two ways. The first way is called the clustered broker. In this way, the clients are load balanced across several servers for a given topic hierarchy. So in this example, publications and subscriptions are load balanced for when the topic is below system. It's not the sys topic. It's a system. To say it's the root topic. It has nothing to do with the sys topic. Of course, there's a need for a load balancing mechanism at the top to assign a server to a client. It can be static or dynamic. A second way to scale is called the distributed broker. With this way, topics, more precisely subtopic hierarchies, can be distributed across servers that are located at the proximity or in the same local network as clients, for example, devices at the edges of the network. There are two gains here. The first one is to scale with the number of clients at the bottom. And the second one is to improve the connectivity at the edges of the network. And the clients at the top could still, of course, publish and subscribe to these topics using the top server. the communication between servers is efficiently handled by server-to-server protocol transmitting batches of messages. In order to implement the spacecraft monitoring solution, we need to map MO, mission operations, to MQTT. In particular, we need to map, so MQTT is here, it's the messaging technology. In particular, we need to map the publish-subscribe interaction pattern to the pub-sub provided by MQTT. It's quite simple because they are very similar. They are publish and subscribe. However, we need to map these concepts that are used by the MAL subscription matching rules. The subscription matching rules that match a publication to subscribers depend on three concepts, the session, the domain, and the entity. Yeah. In this case, an entity is a parameter. I'm going to explain what is a session and a domain after. And these concepts have to be mapped to the topics. We also need to decide how the MQTT connection and the messages are going to be configured in terms of QoS level, clean session flag, and retain messages through MAL QoS properties. First, the mapping to MQTT topics. So MO data are published in a domain for a given session. A domain is a path. It's similar to an MQTT topic. It identifies a subsystem or a device. For example, the device star tracker, STR, of the attitude and orbital control system, AOCS, of the spacecraft. A session is a name identifying the execution context. There are three types of session: live for the current data that are actually that are currently existing in the system, replays for historical data that are republished, replayed from the data store, from the archive. And simul is for test data originating from a simulator. The published parameters have a name and a definition ID. The definition gives the type and the unit of a parameter. So the resulting MQTT topic format is session slash domain, which is hierarchical, slash the parameter name and the definition ID. So, for example, the parameter attitude, definition 671, published by the device star tracker in the attitude and orbital control system of the spacecraft and live. So, the real one coming directly from the spacecraft. Then the mapping to MQTT topic, QoS level. Best effort, so it's a level zero of MQTT, could be used for the real-time telemetry data, the use case number one, as data may be dropped in case of congestion in order to keep up with real-time. So best effort could be used. At least once, level one, QoS level 1, should be used for the payload telemetry delivered to the scientists and for alerts delivered to the control operators. Because in this case, we can't lose any message. It needs to be done in a reliable way. And exactly once could be used, I'm not sure of it, but for alerts that if they are not idempotent. In this case, we really need to deliver them only once. Sessions should not be cleaned, so we can benefit from time decoupling and durable subscriptions. And all messages should be retained This is interesting. This is an interesting feature, provided by MQTT. And in this case, it really solves a use case because then operators don't need to retrieve a snapshot to have the current data values. They directly subscribe and they have the first value. So it's an interesting feature. This is an overview of the solution. What it would like, what it would look like. The spacecraft publishes the real-time telemetry as soon as the ground station is reachable. The telemetry parameters are decoded by the decommutation. This is the name of the component that process the telemetry. The decommutation pushes the data to the message broker. This is where the mapping from mission operations to MQTT takes place, because parameters have to be expressed in terms of mission operations, and then published through the messaging technology MQTT. On top, the tree illustrates the topics hierarchy with the station and spacecraft top level, the subsystems sub-level, the devices, and the parameters. A typical number of parameters is several thousands, up to, in the ATV, it's 50,000 parameters. And the final users, the clients, a smartphone, a tablet, or laptop, or any client, subscribe to these topics. There can be many clients depending on the use case. So that's why the scalability issue has to be addressed. The scalability with the number of MQTT clients. So this slide illustrates the ability of JORAM-MQ to scale with the number of clients by distributing the broker. Well, the broker is generally centralized, but then in this case, it is distributed across several servers. In this case, we assumed that there are many more scientists than control operators. So only the science payload topic hierarchy is clustered to scale with the number of scientists. More information about MQTT with JORAM can be found on our website. The name is mqtt.joramemq.com. So that's it, thank you. Do you have any question?